I would like to welcome you to our fourth annual conference, which we are holding in this magnificent hall at the John Jay College of Criminal Justice. I would like to thank this campus for hosting us and for generously allowing us to convene here in this beautiful space for the exchange and discussion of ideas and perspectives. Of course, I would like to thank especially all of you for being here today with us on this Friday, which for many of us, CUNY students and faculty, is in fact the last day of classes. More specifically, I would like to express my gratitude to a number of individuals without whose support our being here would not have been possible. Of vital importance to us in this regard has been the support of Mr. Jay Hershenson, Senior Vice Chancellor for University Relations at CUNY, not only for support of this conference, but all the other conferences we've had. Our gratitude also goes out to Dr. Ricardo Fernandez, President of Lehman College, where the Institute is physically located, for his continued and steadfast support. Let our thanks be expressed also to the members of our board, many of whom are among us today. A special thank goes to Mr. Jesus Perez, a member, where's Jesus Perez? A member of our board and the executive director of the CUNY Mexican Task Force on Strengthening Educational Opportunities for Mexican and Mexican Americans. I thank him for all the magic he works backstage to make things happen. I don't know how he does it, but makes things happen that you have no idea how they happen. Thank you. I would like to personally thank Dr. Alicia Galvez for entrusting me with the directorship of this institute during her sabbatical leave. It hasn't been really a sabbatical for her. I've made sure of that. I'm sorry, I do apologize. Her unflagging support and thoughtful advice has been of vital importance to me in helping me carry out the work and the functions of the institute. I would like to thank all of the institute becarios. Where are all the becarios? Some of them are here, no? I'd like to thank them for being the beating heart and soul of the institute, for teaching us by their example to be bold, to keep crossing borders, and to overcome limits and limitations, for teaching us the value of hope. Thank you. Lastly, I would like to acknowledge two individuals without whose hard work and dedication we would simply not be here today. The first of these individuals is Ms. Shareni Diaz-Saldana, the Institute's coordinator. And I know that she is literally loathing me at this very moment for mentioning her name publicly, as she's a rather unassuming and private person. Although she will have to forgive me, as I feel it is my duty to make sure that she is not the unsung soldier of this institute, not today. Without her dedication, her attention to detail, and deadlines, for which I am magnificently handicapped, this conference would not have taken place today. I have been lucky to have worked with her this year at the institute. Gracias. Instrumental in planning and carrying out this event has been the work of Citlali Negrete, the coordinator of this conference. Throughout this process, I've come to value her enthusiasm and her optimism in the face of setbacks and obstacles. It has been a pleasure to work with her these last few months. In fact, I would like to tell her something I haven't told her before. As a lover of words, I must admit that reading her name on my screen when looking at my email messages has been a secret source of joy for me. You see, her last name, Citlali, means star in Nahuatl, while her last name, Negrete, means black in Spanish. So there you have it, Citlali Negrete, or Black Star, which always reminded me somehow, and for some reason, of Star Wars. I also learned later, don't ask me how, I learned that there's a hip-hop group in Brooklyn called the Black Star, too, with Mos Def. Don't ask me how I know that. I've crossed borders in my musical taste. but beyond that, I happen to love contradictions, chasms between words, antitheses, and paradoxes. I love them for the unexpected and the uncanny truths that they hold to our surprised faces. We will, in fact, explore many of these rich contradictions in today's lectures and discussions, which I hope you will enjoy as well. But before we do that, I would like to give the floor to Citlali Negrete, who needs to share some important information about the conference. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Once again, thank you for being here today. A little bit of logistics. Want to make sure that we're all on the same page here. You all have a program in front of you, so I'm going to run through it real quick. This morning, we will have our keynote address. Right after, we'll have a short break. Then we'll start with our panel. Our first panel is of families and borders. Shortly after, we will have lunch. We hope you can all accompany us. It'll be held in this room. We will also be showing our panel number two, which is documenting hope and longing. We'll have a short screening and also a Q&A after. And then we'll have another panel, our third panel here is between love and the law. So we're hoping you will be able to stay and join us. Later this afternoon, we'll also have a performance by a ballet folklorico Xochiquetzal. And shortly after, we'll also have our annual CUNY Beca Scholarship Award Ceremony. So if anybody has any questions, I'll be around the room. Also a reminder for our social media folks, we have three handles that are in the back of the program. We have hashtag CUNY Amor, hashtag CUNY Becas, hashtag JLM Mexican Institute. If you'd like to tweet something, Facebook, LinkedIn, please share your thoughts and comments on this. Also, for those interested, we have a Wi-Fi key within the service under John J. Guest. The login request, the username will be CUNY, and the password is CUNY, all lowercase. If anybody has any questions, I'll be around. Thank you.
It's me again, I'm sorry. No, I'm just kidding. The title of today's conference, as you know it, is Amor Más Allá de las Fronteras, or Love Beyond Borders. With it, we are closing a trilogy of conferences envisioned by Dr. Alicia Galvez, entitled Salud, Dinero y Amor. And people have been asking me, did you bring the tequila? No, we can't, unfortunately. This is, after all, the John Jay College of Criminal Justice. We don't want to do that here, especially. Each one of these words, salud, dinero, and amor, has been the theme and the title of three separate annual gatherings that we've had. So we're closing the trilogy today with amor. And I was lucky enough to get that, you know, the most, romantic of the lot. When thinking of these themes, of the themes of this last conference, one name rose most decisively to my mind as a perfect choice as keynote speaker. And that name was Sergio Troncoso. A writer I admire not only for the clarity and the grace, the elegance of his prose, or for asking and exploring relevant and difficult questions, but also because of the centrality of the theme of crossing borders or border crossings in his novels, stories, and essays, and the role of love in making these border crossings. For love seems to propel not only the author's characters, but also his very mind, his very being. In his work, love is a force that challenges us, that drives us to constantly move, to transpose the limits placed on us, and to grow from these experiences. The love that I speak of in Troncoso's work is manifold. The love for his family, love for Mexico, love for El Paso, Texas, love for Cambridge, love for New York, love for reading, and love for writing, and especially love for education. I just finished rereading one of his works, Crossing Borders, which I had enjoyed very much a few years back when it came out, and which I enjoyed even more this second time around. I must say that to me, this is the measure of good literature. That is much like good wine. It gets better with aging. For a good book to me is one I want to keep revisiting, and that seems better every time I read it. Like the sight of a tryst or a romantic encounter, or even the scene of a crime. It is the sight of power, powerful encounters suffused with meanings and wonder. Maybe it's just that I'm a better reader now than I was a few years ago. If this is in true fact, there's no doubt in my mind that it is thanks to exceptional works such as those of Sergio Troncoso who challenges us to grow and become better readers. Without further ado, it is for me an honor and a pleasure to introduce to you our keynote speaker, Mr. Sergio Troncoso. On this day, es el día del maestro en México, ¿no? Bienvenido a un maestro, Sergio Troncoso.
Wow, what a great introduction. I hope I don't blow it. I wanted to thank first Professor Daniel Fernandez. This is what happens when you get old. For inviting me to the fourth annual conference of the of the Jaime Lucero Mexican Studies Institute. And, you know, found that I've been learning about it as I got invited in 2012. And it's the first Institute of Mexican Studies located east of the Mississippi River. So after a few brief comments and a reading from one of my books, from Crossing Borders, I'll be happy to answer any of your questions, because I really love Q&A. And so, you know, I kept thinking when I got this invite and said, why this institute? It's four subway stops from my house on the Upper West Side, from my apartment. And of course, the reason is this growing diaspora of Mexicanos and Mexican Americans, you know, beyond the border, and right here to New York City, but to many other places, Iowa and Kansas City, et cetera. It's certainly reflected in the growing percentage of Mexicanos as part of the New York Latino population, and it's really reflected in my own journey and arrival here in New York in 1990, and it's kind of shocking to me to think that I've been here 25 years. I was the son of Mexican immigrants from Chihuahua, as I spoke to some of you, and I was born in Isleta, which is a little town. It's really a little kind of like a neighborhood on the outskirts of El Paso, Texas. And to paraphrase Tina Fey as Sarah Palin, I could see Mexico from my house. and you know, we began with an outhouse in the backyard and kerosene lamps and stoves, lámparas de petróleo. And it was a great place to grow up, I thought. You know, I loved playing in the irrigation canals and the cotton fields. We would go to Juarez, you know, every weekend for a dinner with La Familia. And this was sort of my upbringing. As I tell some of my students at Yale, I said it was kind of a Tom Sawyer-ish existence, but Mexican style. And I love just how I grew up. And I contrast that as an 18-year-old, because I have an 18-year-old now and a 22-year-old. And so my 18-year-old is a senior in high school. So when I was a senior in high school, I was burning bonfires at the levee in the back of my pickup with my friends and drinking and enjoying the last month of high school, very different from how you're doing it here in the Upper West Side. And so from that sort of beginning, I, as an 18-year-old, went to Harvard. And for me, going to Harvard was like going to Mars. I had never seen Harvard. I didn't even know what the Ivy League was. I had only seen it in a catalog, and people said, go to Harvard because John Kennedy went there. And you know, for my mother, John Kennedy was like a god. So I had no clue what I was getting myself into. And I went and I showed up at Harvard with Led Zeppelin t-shirts and bell-bottom jeans. When the cab driver was pulling into Harvard Square, I asked him, well, you're taking me to a park, where's the school? And he said, it's all around you, this is the school. So, you know, I was this Mexicano with just really no clue what was going on. And so at Harvard, one of the things I did, Esther, I got over the shock of being there, is I started studying Mexico. I spent literally 4 years at Harvard studying with people like John Womack, who became my mentor, and Terry Carl, studying Mexico, because I knew when I went there that I knew next to nothing about my Mexican heritage. I knew next to nothing about where my parents were from, Chihuahua, all the stories about La Revolución Mexicana. Nada, because of course in Texas high schools, you know, Mexicanos and Chicanos are for the most part invisible. And so I took it upon myself to educate myself about that heritage. So I had to go to Harvard to learn about Mexico. Imagine that. And so after that, I went, I got a Fulbright, I won a Fulbright, and spent a year in Coyoacán, in the southern part of Mexico City. And studying, reading everybody from Vargas Llosa and Isabel Allende, and studying economics and politics in El Colegio de México and UNAM, and really deciding where I belong. Because for me, it was a real question at that time. am I a Mexicano? Do I stay here and never go back? Or and is Spanish my primary language? Or do I go back and become an Americano? And that's why I went to Mexico, because I really was not sure and I was debating. And then after that, I came back to Yale and I did a graduate degree in international relations and then another graduate degree later in philosophy. And finally, when I was sick of the academy and had spent way too much time in school, I ended up in New York, married in 1990, and started writing stories and books. So, you know, and I give you this sort of short, brief history to get into this concept of crossing borders that Professor Fernandez mentioned, and one of my books is called Crossing Borders, Personal Essays. And I want to point out four different ways I cross borders and what they meant to me and how I have tried to translate them into literature, into nonfiction literature and fiction literature. I think the first border I crossed was linguistic, you know, going from Spanish to English and back. But also when I was growing up in Isleta and then ended up at Harvard, you know, without a clue, I really had to improve my English. It's sort of, I call it English 2.0. You know, I had a certain level of proficiency in Texas and Isleta, but then when I went to Harvard and I said, oh my God, everybody's so much more sophisticated than I am and I'm fumbling through grammar, et cetera, I took it upon myself to improve my English so it was academic ready, so it was a literary quality. So it was really learning on the fly. And I think a lot of us who cross a lot of these borders have to learn on the fly, have to learn how to adapt quickly when you're like basically a shark tank like Harvard and you say, oh my God, I don't want to fail. And so you start like thinking, what do I need to do so that I get past this semester? And that was certainly me at Harvard. But I didn't stop there. Once I got comfortable and then I went to Yale as a grad student, I started really getting into philosophy. And I learned German, and I spent some time in Germany and Austria because I wanted to read people like Thomas Mann in the original. I wanted to read Heidegger and Nietzsche. And so I kept crossing linguistic borders beyond Spanish to English, but into German as well. And so this is something I would encourage all of you to do. Not just if you know English well, but don't know Spanish very well, make sure you know Spanish well. But then keep going. Once you spend some time and understand that language, keep going to another language, because it really does open up all sorts of worlds. I think the second major border I crossed that had an impact on my work was geographic. And too often we don't think about what it does to you, to the buildings around you or the lack of. And so in the desert southwest in Isleta, it was really these huge panoramas. Mountainsides, el desierto. And in a sense, I got an appreciation for the sense of awe of the nature around me. And of course, going from that, I call it sort of horizontal living, to being amontonado in the Ivy League, you know, to New York City, where you can't see, you know, the horizon. Just look outside your world. And you're living with people in a building like I am in the Upper West Side in 86 and Broadway, in which the entire apartment building is as big as Isleta. And it's only in one block. So it's sort of vertical living. And your neighbors are 10 feet away, and you can hear them. And I think it affects how you think and how you see yourself as part of the world. I think the third major border I cross is cultural. You know, in El Paso, Mexicanos have been the majority for at least 100 years. And so everybody in El Paso, from the poor people to the rich people, it's 80% Mexicano at the moment. And Juarez is right next door, so it's not even Mexican-American or Hispanic. It's Mexicano. You hear more Spanish on the streets than you do English. And so this growing up affected me in the sense of I felt normal when I went to Harvard. I felt abnormal when I ended up at Harvard because it had an important psychological function people at Harvard said, you know, Sergio, you don't act like a minority. And I kept thinking, like, what does that mean? Does that mean I don't act subservient? Does that mean I don't act with self-hate? Because I was not a minority in El Paso. I was in the majority, and that was normal. And so I think it had an impact in how I saw myself. And at Harvard, of course, that's the first time I started feeling brown against a white background. That's how I write about it. And I started feeling alienated. I started feeling like an outsider, like I didn't belong. And, you know, I was badly dressed. I didn't even have a summer coat at Harvard because I didn't know that Boston got cold. So I had to buy a used coat at Keezer's, this used clothing store at Harvard, so that I wouldn't freeze to death. But as I was being sort of feeling like an outsider, I was also processing it. I was also looking at this new Ivy League world and Boston, and I was writing in journals because I would see the hypocrisies, the little, you know, the way people would cut you because, you know, hablas con acento or whatever. So I was processing it. I wasn't saying much because I was intimidated, and I was having a discussion with one of the students here that gets a little nervous when they're up here talking. And I'd say that's one of the things we need to work on, people talking extemporaneously in public all the time, because I didn't say anything at Harvard for 2 years. I was so intimidated. I felt Harvard had made a mistake. But I learned. I learned to talk in front of people. But I also processed it by writing about it. For me, it was, I don't have to say anything, but I can actually write about it and what I'm seeing and what I'm doing. And what I started doing, I started picking and choosing the things I liked about where I grew up in Isleta, the discipline, the hard work, the orientation with familia. That thing I liked. I didn't like the machismo. I've always, if you've read my work, I've had a lot of issues with my father. You know, my hero was my mother. She was the reader. She was the one who loved ideas. She was much more intelligent than her station. She decided to be a Mexican mother, stay-at-home mother, but I gave her a test before I left for Harvard. And she, I think we got up to number 48 of names and addresses and phone numbers she kept in her head. She never wrote anything down. And she had all her address book up here. And she had this fantastic memory, and luckily I think I inherited her memory. But she could have been a CEO, and she just decided, no, I want to be a mother. So in many ways I got along much better with my mother than my father, but I started picking and choosing what I liked from each place. From Harvard, I liked the intellectual rigor. I liked the solitary focus on your work and the competition. You know, I like to compete, you know. And as I tell people, si me picas, te pico. You know, that's how I grew up. And of course, the cultural and frenetic mezcla in New York also started affecting me, being exposed to different religions, different ethnicities as well. I think the fourth border I crossed from going from Isleta to New York and in between was religious. You know, I grew up as in an obedient Catholic family. My mother, I call her Torque Quemada. Do you know, I assume you know who Torque Quemada is. You know, she is a Catholic. She still goes to Mass 3 to 4 times a week. And when I left for Harvard, I started becoming more of a lapsed Catholic, criticizing more of the Catholicism I grew up with. But one of the things I do appreciate is that without my mother's Catholicism and moral focus from that, and the discipline I got from that, I probably would have never left Isleta. Because my mother's moral foundation allowed me to stay away from gangs, because there were gangs, you know, Barraca contra Calavera. There was a lot of violence in my neighborhood, drugs. And without that focus, I probably would have not survived. So although I became more of a lapsed Catholic, I still value what she gave us. And I still drive her to church, you know, when I'm there in Isleta. So, you know, at Harvard, I started being more critical of the Catholic Church. And then by Yale, of course, when I started reading Nietzsche, God is Dead, and all of this philosophy, I became more of an agnostic and a little bit more critical. And then even to New York, to keep crossing that religious border. I got married. My wife, Huerita, from Chicago, and Boston. Habla español mejor que casi todos mis amigos chicanos y latinos, because she does all her work in Spanish, but she's Jewish. And so I started attending High Holy Day services with her. I mean, I'm not that religious, but I wanted to accompany my wife. So here in New York, we attend these services once in a while, and I've even written for Hadassah magazine about a Latino in a Jewish world. Keep crossing borders. And so that, and finally, even not even that, just that, but attending graduations and family get-togethers with my Muslim nieces and my Muslim nephews, because my sister converted about 30 years ago and became a Chicana Musulmana. So there you go. And so if you wanna sort of understand and look at this in this book, From This Wicked Patch of Dust, which is a novel, it's a semi-fictional account of my family, of a family that began in La Frontera, son puros mexicanos, and the kids start adopting different religions, different politics, different geographies. And so the root of the novel, the question at the novel is, how do we stay a family together, unidos, as people are going in different directions? And it's really an allegory to what's going on with the country, right? How do we remain a we as we're pulling in different political, geographic, ethnic directions? And so that was the challenge I wanted to do in the novel, replay some of these themes that I was living. And so as I've told people many times, that I would be the perfect mayor of Jerusalem. You know, my wife is Jewish, my parents are Christian Catholic, and my sister's Muslim. And that's true. You know, too bad I don't live in Jerusalem. So how does this background, how does it affected my literary work? My novels, my short story collections, my essay collections. And I think one of the aims of my literary work, if you've read my work, and Dr. Fernandez has, is that I really want to affect multiple disparate communities. I'm interested in influencing and affecting high schoolers back in Isleta. I just had a Skype call last week with a high schooler, a high school class in El Paso. I'm interested in affecting new immigrants, and those trying to reach that promised land, just like my parents were, trying to educate their children. And readers, of course, also along the United States-Mexico border, just like I was. But I'm also interested in affecting professors, you know, this table. You know, professors with PhDs, people in graduate programs, in the Ivy League. It's often very disparate communities I'm trying to influence in how they think about not just reading and education, but Mexicanos and Chicanos. And I'm also trying to influence this growing Mexican-American middle class that I see in places like Kansas City and Iowa and even in New York. You know, people who are moving up that rung, and their world is very different from my parents' world. It's more my world, and it's even more my children's world. So I think some of the things that have helped me to do this reaching out to disparate communities is, I call it, you have to be good at translating. And I don't mean just translating from English to Spanish or Spanish to English and back, which I've done, but you have to be able to talk and affect those without a formal education, but who still have, let's say, an innate interest, an imagination, an intelligence to help themselves and help their neighborhoods. And I also want to affect and translate to those with PhDs, people who understand how to write books, who understand how to get tenure, but they don't understand intangibles. They don't understand what I call innumerables, things you can't number. Because, of course, when you live in the academy as much as I do, you know that to get tenure, to move up that ladder, you need to quantify everything and do it in a certain way, but that's not necessarily education in my mind. You know, you need to understand things like the Mexicano culture can vary from family to family within the same block, when the whole block is Mexicano, when the whole neighborhood is Mexicano, when even the whole city is Mexicano, but there are differences within families. And so some families are successful in creating a very different culture within their little island that helps their kids to be readers, that helps their kids to focus on education, even when their resources are very small. And these are all intangibles that often are ignored by academics, but it has to do with family responsibility, has to do with involvement, parental involvement, discipline, with showing parents practices that create a reading culture at home, even in poor communities, and really against the materialistic and image-infatuated culture around them. And by the way, this is a culture I see as much on the Upper West Side as I see in Isleta. And it's something we need to actually push against. And so it's about translating the immigrant values that I learned in Isleta for success, things like hard work, family orientation, anti-materialism, self-reliance, honesty, to New York and beyond, and many of these places that are had these growing Latino populations. So as I have said in many talks all across the country, that Isleta and places like Isleta have as much to teach Harvard and Yale as Harvard and Yale have to teach Isleta. And often I think we forget that. And by the way, storytelling is a way of doing this translation. The very first story I wrote at Yale was about this Chicano at Yale calling his abuelita, it's called the abuelita, and in El Paso, and his abuelita does not have more than a third grade education, but she's very intelligent in a way that's not academic. She understands people, understands argument. So they're having this argument about what? Heidegger. They're talking about Heidegger's being towards death. And so of course it astonished people when the story came out that it was about complex ideas, yet it was about Chicanos, and it was breaking stereotypes. You know, Chicanos can think. They're reading Heidegger and Nietzsche. Isn't that shocking? But it also was a vehicle not just to reach the community back home with complex ideas through stories, but it was also to show my philosophy professors at Yale that you can actually bring these discussions of philosophy to the street, to the marketplace, just the old way, the way Aristotle and Plato used to do it all the time. It was not something just for these walls. It was something to do out there. And so storytelling was this way of translating all sorts of complex ideas. I think another skill that helped me to reach disparate communities was this concept, this precept that my mother always tells me when I talk to her. I just talked to her yesterday, and she said, no te creas muy muy. You know, no te creas, you know, with your nose in the air, just because you're from Harvard and Yale, no te creas muy muy. You know, don't think of yourself as too much, too much. And this is about that our, you know, we need to reach out to many communities, even if you have made it, even if you are now, you know, sitting in a nice apartment on the Upper West Side, it's your responsibility to go out and reach out to other communities. It's about familia in the broader sense of the word, beyond your blood, to reach others who are marginalized, maybe as you were, and to keep affecting, you know, how they're thinking and to change culture and to use yourself as an example for others. And I mean a true example, you know, not saying, oh, Sergio did it perfectly, isn't that great, but the good, the bad, and the ugly. As somebody who's read my work, I'm actually as critical about the stupidities and mistakes that I've made because readers understand that when you're really digging into yourself in an honest way, not in a propaganda way. And so you need to set yourself as an example, a true example, and I think that's very important. And then for you, those of you in the room right now, I think the call is this from me. It don't just write for other academics, if you're a professor, you know, but go out with your ideas in the community. Go to the street corners, go to the living rooms, talk to people outside of the academy, because too often I think we have that huge distance between what's being learned here but not applied out there. And I think you have to go out there with humility, perseverance, and really looking at people, at everybody as individuals, you know, from roofers and carpenters to PhDs, you know, caring. And I think we need to nurture this sense of caring and intense and constant curiosity. I think as we get older, you will see los ojos empiezan a cerrarte. Right. You start assuming ya sé todo, and you start assuming that you see everything, and you don't. That quite the opposite. You start accumulating prejudices and your station, and you stop looking, and looking at something that needs to be nurtured in this intense way. I think another thing that I did to help me in my work is, and this is sort of a second moral precept, is I wrote simply about complex ideas, because I wanted to communicate my ideas in a straightforward manner to communities that were too often ignored by intellectuals, but yet also did not want to sacrifice the complexity of what I was talking about, the ideas, because I wanted to change the minds of powerful people in positions of power, deans and PhD people and professors. So again, trying to reach out to disparate communities, not just to the community that maybe would most benefit me, but because of this moral responsibility that you should feel to others. And I think in literary fiction, my world, I think too often we extol the style and voice and somewhat superficial aspects of a story, when the ideas behind the story are pedestrian and kind of stupid. You know, it's almost un poco superficial. You know, too much Miley Cyrus, too much Kim Kardashian. Y estamos ya no sabemos cómo pensar. And I think that's the problem even in storytelling and what books are published. Whereas in philosophy and literature, you know, we still have that suspicion from Plato that the poets are to be guarded against. Why? Because when somebody says something beautifully, it almost prevents thinking. And Plato warned us against the poets. And I think and what's much more important is the content of the story, not how the story is told. But of course, in our world that we live in, you know, we give a lot of emphasis on the superficial aspects of a story. Does it take us for a ride? You know, is it like a thriller? And lo que están diciendo son puras estupideces. So I certainly share that philosophical suspicion of the poets. And I'm an iconoclast. I'm a skeptic. I'm a dissenter of modern society and images and superficiality. I think, as my mother would say, eres muy terco, you know, eres muy independiente. And I don't care, because I think I'd like to point out the things that I think other people don't see. So again, always writing simply about complex ideas. I think another sort of idea that I want to communicate to you is something I call the morality of description. In literary fiction and nonfiction. And I'm going to give you a couple examples, but it really just means this: that what we focus on, or how we focus on it, whether we are fiction or nonfiction writers, gives phenomena importance, or it takes it away from something else. And I'll give you an example, and I've written about this in a few essays. I've been asked to do book reviews all the time by publishers and newspapers. And so they asked, a few years ago, somebody asked me to read a book called The General and the Jaguar by Eileen Wellsom. And it's a history book on the John Pershing's punitive expedition into Mexico when he's chasing Francisco Villa, Pancho Villa. Pancho Villa, at the tail end of the revolution, he goes to Columbus, New Mexico, he killed some people, he's trying to drag the United States into the war because his effort against Carranza is waning, and so this is what he does. And then after he goes into Columbus, they send in John Pershing to try to get him. And John Pershing fails, and it's about this punitive expedition. And Eileen Wellsom is a very good writer. She won the Pulitzer for a book on the nuclear war. So I was reviewing this book, and one of the things I learned about this history book, it's beautifully written. It reads like a novel. You're in there and you're reading, and the John Pershing soldiers, she goes into military archives and she really understands their background, she understands their family background, she understands what John Pershing liked to eat in the morning. You know, really describes them in loving detail. And then the interesting thing that happens is most of the book happens in Mexico. And as Pershing is pursuing Villa, when Eileen Wellsom describes the Mexicans that die in these conflagrations, and much more Mexicanos die when Pershing is following or trying to get to Villa in Chihuahua and other places than Pershing's men, about 3-1, that the Mexicans are always described as Mexicans. Like 100 Mexicans die, they're just Mexicans. And so I kept digging into it, and so I noticed a few grammatical mistakes in the Spanish, in Wellsom's book, And then in the acknowledgement, she thanked somebody for correcting her Spanish. And so, you know, I keep digging. I'm like a little like hound dog looking at things. And so I look at 785 bibliographical references she has in this history book. And I looked at all of them. And only two of them are in Spanish, and they're both translated. And what you conclude is that Eileen Weltham, and I write about this in a review, which ended up being a hard-hitting review, is that Eileen Weltham does not know Spanish. So she couldn't go into the Mexican archive, and there's hundreds of them in Chihuahua, to understand the soldiers fighting for Villa, to get a sense of Villa from the other side and what it meant for you know, some of these soldiers to fight for social justice. She saw them as just kind of a blanket category because of her language deficiency. She did not see them as individuals. She saw, in fact, Villa as sort of like an animal. And this is a history book that's beautifully written, that people read, and people think this is history, and it's not. It's a very limited English-only perspective from American sources. And as I say in the review, if I'm writing a book on the French Revolution, I better know French, right? And so this is the morality of description. What you choose to focus on and what you choose to ignore gives things importance and takes it away from something else. And so I never heard back from Eileen Weltham. But and another, just to give you another example of this morality of description, and this is one is in this book, Crossing Borders. It's a little essay I wrote called Illegal is Illegal. So I go out from my Upper West Side apartment, and about two blocks away on 86th and Broadway, there's this big mega Victoria's Secret superstore. I never look at the 10-foot models on the windows. Of course, I'm very serious, never look at that stuff. But I go by this place all the time when I go get my coffee. A few years ago, there was work being done in front of the Victoria's Secret. They were doing the sidewalk again. And I noticed, I would keep going back, that they were tearing up the sidewalk. These guys in sweaty t-shirts and llenos de polvo, with jackhammers redoing the Victoria's Secret sidewalk, were ignored by almost every passerby. All the liberals that were in the Upper West Side that would go back, all of them would be looking at the Victoria's Secret supermodels, you know, on the walls, but they would never look at or even interact with what I ended up finding out were all Mexicanos working on the sidewalks, redoing, you know, being exploited by Victoria's Secret and to redo and have a new sidewalk. And so I started talking to them, because they were there for a while. And the first time I talked to them, one of them was from Puebla, the other one was from Guanajuato. And they thought I was like a migra guy. And I said, no, I'm not a migra guy. I'm just a guy who lives two blocks away and I want to talk to you. You know, and it's how right in front of us, right in our neighborhood, things we walk by, we ignore. We start looking at a world with cliche eyes. You know, undocumented workers that are being used by Victoria's Secret and wherever else, they're invisible. You don't see them. People don't see them. And so it requires us to push ourselves to open our eyes to see what is right in front of our eyes and how much we miss. And there's a woman that I, and again, it's back to the morality of description concept that I talked about, how much we miss right in front of our eyes. And there's a woman called Alexandra Horowitz that just did a book called On Looking, in which she goes to a one Manhattan block in front of Columbus University with 11 different experts. And one of them is a geologist, another one is an architect, another one is a child. She goes in with her five-year-old. What they see, radically different. You would think the same block, ya vimos todo, ya sabemos todo. Quite the opposite. We are missing so much right in front of our eyes. And I think that's, you know, the issue that I'm trying to bring out with this concept of morality of description. So just to end a little bit, and then I'll get to my reading, this concept of radical empathy that I talk about, you know, requires work not just about what is written, but also requires work on the moral education of the writers and scholars and thinkers that we are. And this is about the importance of the humanities. It's not just about what we're producing, but it's about the people who are producing it. You know, are you opening up their minds so that they're really looking at the things that are right in front of them that they often ignore? You know, we need to teach ourselves to look outside the box, to teach ourselves to see what is overlooked in front of our faces, and to question our own limitations and perspectives, and do what is necessary to ameliorate those weaknesses and limitations. You know, this is how I think we start becoming, in my mind, more of a we in this country, and not just an island of I's, or an island of us versus them. And we really need to get away from a sense of understanding that is quick, or image-related, or prejudices masquerading as eloquent thoughts. You know, a good example would be Fox News. But get to a sense of understanding that means engagement, means putting yourself in someone else's shoes. Understanding as a slow curiosity with self-reflection, and really understanding as building community. So let me now, I'm going to read from a part of my book called Finding Our Voice from Literacy to Literature. And this is part of something called the White Fund Lecture, created by Judge Appleton White. He was a contemporary of Thoreau and Emerson. And so, and he established this lecture series in Massachusetts. And it was given, this lecture was given by Frederick Douglass, was given by Horace Greeley, even Ernest Hemingway. So when they asked me to do it, I said, oh, wow, this is exciting. So this is the last part of that essay. What did this culture from my family, reading and libraries and these teachers and schools eventually accomplish? They provided me with an education. But this word education means more than what you learn in school. Education to me means finding your own voice and having the ability to accomplish your dreams and producing your own opportunities to realize the work that defines you as a human being. My education gave me the skills and the focus and the discipline to write literature. I was able to traverse the chasm from literacy to literature. That was my road to success. For others, their education may not lead them to writing or short stories or novels, but maybe they will find their voices as great engineers, path-breaking doctors, or astute lawyers. Maybe others with their education will discover meaningful work as teacher or artist. But the point is that education means freedom to define yourself in the world, the freedom to be successful in your chosen field. Education finally is power. So as you struggle to get educated, and by the way, if you have a PhD, I don't think you're educated. That's not what it means to me. If you struggle to get educated in school and beyond, remember that you are readying yourself to leave your mark on the world. This precious opportunity, the opportunity and promise of an educated life, should be seized with gusto. You should readily sacrifice every bit of energy to ensure that this opportunity continues within you beyond your school exams or the exhortations of your teachers. Because once education becomes part of your character, then you become a self-propelled human being, a lover of questions and a relentless seeker of answers. You will be on your way to achieving what Aristotle might call the full potential of a human being. I believe my primary role as a writer and lecturer is to help educate myself and others. I want to bring people back to thinking, back to reading, back to taking the time to consider the many complex possibilities in an excellent story. A good writer should ask the reader to take a minute, and then take an hour, and then perhaps more than that, a few days, to immerse the reader in a story that brings forth complex characters, not caricatures, difficult problems which may or may not have easy solutions, if they have solutions at all. A good writer should be able to communicate to the reader, I know your life. I know what you have truly experienced. It's not right or wrong. It's survival. It's making mistakes and trying to redeem yourself. It's imperfections and trying to make yourself better. It's outrages and crimes and insults, which often are not righted, but which you have to fix yourself in your own mind, in your own heart, so that you are not poisoned. All these things and more a writer should do for a reader. And a good story that teaches the reader a new world of character dons and characters who may not be like you, but yes, you understand them. You want to know what happens to them. And when they are hurt, physically or emotionally, you as a reader are hurt too. A good writer teaches the reader this empathy, but not by beating you over the head and saying, believe in this protagonist or else, but by finding what is common between reader and character, and by encouraging the reader to think and truly participate in making a story come alive. Is it at all surprising that throughout the centuries, different dictators have ended up burning books to stop this quiet revolution of empathy? How do we as Mexicanos and Latinos find our political and cultural voice in America? We find it by being self-disciplined and self-reliant. We find it by adapting ourselves, just as my parents did, to the English language, to a culture that expects you to stand up to be heard. We find it by responding to, instead of ignoring, the false caricatures of Latinos portrayed by those fearful of change, by those who do not want to share power with a rising minority. We find our voice by reaching out to others. While some slam the door in our faces, others will help us. They will be the ones who embrace the spirit of Judge White to be exacting and honest with yourself while being open to strangers and their new worlds. We find our voice by taking the stones and arrows flung our way, real and imagined, and binding our wounds and responding so that by word and deed, everyone will know we will never give up. Finally, we find our voice by teaching, by believing we are vehicles to help others, all others, but in particular those nearby, those we love, our children, our neighbors. We help them by teaching them what we know and by listening for what they can teach us to become better human beings. Thank you. So if we have a few moments, I would love to answer questions. En español o en inglés? Don't be shy, I don't bite. I could ask questions like I do in my class, make you nervous. I'm sure you have questions. Oh, back there. Oh, great.
And I've been here since 2008. And one of the things that I have experienced since I've been in New York is disparate communities within the Latino population, where we seem to be at odds against each other. And it's really disheartening to me, because if we were just to work together, we could become a great force. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, there are so many different Latinos throughout the country, but we're always fighting against each other for every little reason, instead of working towards the same end. Have you come across that yourself?
Envidia? Yeah. Yeah, I mean, envidia, right? I mean, that's often what I see, how it starts in some ways. I do, and it happens all the time, believe me. You know, sometimes my biggest critics are other Latinos or Chicanos. But I think one of the most important things that I learned in my life is don't be defined by your critics. don't be defined by, you listen to them, you know, and I certainly do, even within your own community. But try to put out what you believe is the positive, the solutions, and just keep going. So, you know, you can spend your time, whether you're responding to Fox News or responding to those within the Latino community that are more like Fox News, and you'd be surprised how many of them there are. Or you can start creating a different positive example and work that tells us who we want to be rather than who we're not by the stupid critics that you think you know, are getting it wrong about our community. So yeah, I mean, I see that all the time, and I sometimes address it. It depends on the, you know, on the panel, but I've been on panels with all Latino writers, and we start going at each other como perros, you know, and it's kind of stupid. But I think it happens in all communities. I think I have a lot of friends who are, you know, in the African American literary community. It happens in their community, in the, you know, in my wife's community. You know, you're not a real Jew, you know, within the Jewish community, because you don't, are not Orthodox, et cetera. So every community, I think, has that kind of backbiting aspect in which within the community people are attacking each other for whatever the reason. And I think the point is to get your point across and keep being positive and producing your work that you think changes the culture in a positive way. So yes, I do see it, but I also, it's important to understand how to react to it so that you don't waste your time. As long as you're being self-critical, you know, because I listen to my critics, I don't necessarily respond to them, but I see, you know, am I really truly doing that? And you know, there is a sense of envidia, jealousy, at a certain point when you start becoming famous. So the higher up you are, the more people are hitting you at the knees. I think that's been true of any different community. So, in the yellow, I think you had a question, right? Just
really
loud. I'm
poquito sordo. I really enjoyed your talk
as
a Chicana, you know, navigating like graduate school from Los Angeles coming to the East Coast. So I really enjoyed your talk. I could identify with a lot of your speech. I had a question about your whole critique of, like, you know, coming from this Ivy League world and you know, being not able to speak up. You know, your first 2 years, you talked about that, and I could definitely relate to that as well. But how do you think having access to like these Ivy League centers like impacted your life as a writer? How do you feel like that's opened up a particular world that perhaps some Chicanos who, you know, didn't get to Yale or Harvard would be impacted?
You go to Stanford, but. How did it open up worlds? Well, I mean, it's positive and negative. You'd be surprised. You know, see, everyone says, oh, Harvard and Yale, you must, you know, have it made. But it's actually, among some people, when we talk, you know, to relate to the first question that you asked in blue, Harvard and Yale became an albatross. You know, ya no eres Chicano, because you went to Harvard and Yale. And of course, that's ridiculous. Of course you still are. But I think in the sense of, at least these particular schools, they taught me academic rigor. And a lot of it was fear. You know, I did not want to fail out of Harvard because I didn't want to go back to El Paso with my tail between the legs. And so I learned to fight back, you know, in seminar. And it's intellectual combat. That's what it is at these places. And it's not just Harvard and Yale, University of Michigan or Stanford or many of these great schools. You know, it's intellectual combat, and you have to learn to speak up and fight back. And it took me years, you know, to get over my my vergüenza of, like, you know, I don't belong here. Harvard made a mistake. I can't talk. You know, I can't say it as eloquently as it's my, you know, my colleague. And but I learned, because I just, a lot of it was fear and not fighting back. So I think in the sense of opening up that world of intellectual rigor, certainly. There were all sorts of very specific things that happened for me at Harvard. For example, I met Willie Velasquez. You know who Willie Velasquez is? He's a great, other than Cesar Chavez, he's probably one of the most important figures in the Southwest in terms of registering Latino voters. He founded the Southwest Voter Registration Project, and Willie Velasquez was a Harvard Fellow. And so he was there at the Institute of Politics, and he talked to me. He marched with Cesar Chavez. He knew the entire history of that movement, and he started his own Southwest Voter Registration Project. And so I would meet people like that. I think Harvard and Yale open up people like that, and who go through these institutions. I think a lot of the things that, the other sort of aspects that, you know, just to get to answer your question, things that open up, you know, I teach at Yale. So I get to influence students who are coming in who may not be Latinos, but who may also have a deep interest in this community. Just like my wife, you know, my wife was fluent in Spanish, did her thesis on Chile, by the way. And so we had the same thesis advisor. And so there are a lot of people who are going to these institutions that have deep interest in Latino and Latin American culture, and I got to meet them and appreciate it. And I met, for example, John Womack, who became really my mentor at Harvard. He was chairman of the history department at Harvard, and he was like me. See, these people think of Harvard, and he would walk around in jeans and cowboy boots. He was from Oklahoma, John Womack didn't give a shit about Harvard pretension, but he was a Rhodes Scholar and chairman of the history department. You know, here, he had it here. He didn't care about the other crap. And that's the kind of guy I liked at Harvard. And so, you know, he influenced me, and he said, you know, what you should focus on is your work. People will define you by your work. If your work is good, it doesn't matter if you don't have the pedigree, if you don't have Andover or Exeter, qualifications. And so I think these kinds of people were very influential. The other thing that I noticed is I spent a lot of time at Harvard. I don't know if you see my little bookmark, but The Nature of Truth, that novel, it's set at Yale. That's an entire critique of the Ivy League and places like the Ivy League, the savagery that goes on in seminars on that they destroyen, you know, really to get power. They destroy you to get power. And it's all about the nature of truth and the pursuit of truth in places like Yale, so and Harvard and Stanford and many of the other places. So I think not only did it open up doors, but it, I think, allowed me to see a world in which too often we hold up high, but we need to look at it critically as well, and not just accept because of the name that it's supposed to be great or perfect or whatever. So I don't know if that answers your question. Any other questions? Allá atrás. So one more? Okay.
My question is about the publishers.
The what?
The publishers.
Uh-huh.
It's about, like, I like to read literature from all over.
Mm-hmm.
So I read literature from whites, from African Americans, from Latino writers. But I always find that the Latino and the African American literature is, like, harsh, harder life. And I always wonder if, and then the white literature is
if the publisher wants to demonize
Latinos literature or African American,
right,
because you can notice the different kind of writing.
Right.
I was taking one kind of class, and a white guy was saying, you know, why don't the Latinos write like something like more nicer, like you mentioned, some writer, like, you know, Wonderful Life.
It's a Wonderful Life? Or like 50 Shades of Grease, or you know, no. But this is a really fascinating question. Well, some Latinos are writing that. I think it's a big community with a lot of different interests. I mean, I know a lot of writers that are writing. The publishers. Yeah, I mean, you mean like the stereotypes that the publishers. Well, I think it's an excellent question. I mean, the first thing is the publishing world is changing drastically. New York is not, I mean, most people want to get published by a New York publisher. That's like their idea. But New York is in crisis. in large part because the book industry is in crisis. Barnes & Noble used to be the big bad wolf, and now it's actually, you're lucky if it doesn't go bankrupt. And when Barnes & Noble, if and when it goes bankrupt, the people who will be hurt the most will be New York, the five New York publishers, because that is their distribution system. So way back when, you wanted to be published by Knopf and by you know, Dell or whoever, and some of my work had been published by them. But I think it's becoming more decentralized. And you are right. I an editor from Dutton once called me to his office and said, "Sergio, we really like your sex scenes. Why don't you write?" No, this was the discussion they had with me. "Why don't you write about a Chicano going to Harvard and discovering himself through his sexcapades?" right. That was my response. Like, what do you think I do? You know, and so they have these stereotypes of what they think the rest of the world will buy from Latinos. You know, they want hot Latinos and hot Latinas. I think for me, it was my obligation to say, first, you're wrong and you're idiotic, but I'm not going to do that. And also to believe that there are many other high-quality publishers, like Arte Publico, like a lot of university presses, like Grey Wolf Press, that are not in the New York world, that are taking a much more open-minded way of displaying Latinos. And it's changing. I mean, it's an industry that's in flux in many ways. So, you know, and when you have all these different, for example, now the interesting thing that happened, I was telling Daniel, is that about a few weeks ago, my publisher called me and said, this one, Crossing Borders, that appeared in Arte Publico, and Arte Publico is the largest publisher of Latino works in the United States, that the city of New York was buying 16,000 copies of this book. And I guess they're using it in the school. So suddenly, of course, the New York publishers are calling me because they say, "Oh my God, how did he get that?" Right? So sometimes it comes from the other side. They see that they're missing the writers because I don't care about New York and I know New York publishing. And so the thing is to create quality work, because New York publishing is very conservative. And I don't mean politically. I mean they go for what works already. So if you sell 50,000, 100,000, suddenly they're interested in you. So they're only, because of their overhead, really, the economics of the business here in New York is that they have to, you know, they have to sell 50,000, 100,000 copies simply to pay the bills. So don't be mesmerized by New York. Go to other publishers outside, and if you want a list, I will happily give you a list. Just send me an email. And you know, Benjamin Sainz, I think you know, I'm sure from El Paso, know Benjamin Sainz. But he published with Cinco Puntos Press, an El Paso publisher. He won the Penn Faulkner 2 years ago, and it shocked the hell out of New York. You know, there was this small press in El Paso that won the second biggest prize than the Pulitzer, from El Paso. So the world is changing. And by the way, this is a secret between you and all of us, but I am going to be one of the three national judges for the Penn Faulkner this year. And as my editor said, you have to accept it, because they don't ask Latinos, and they only ask three people in the country, and you're one of those three. And it's they pay you a lot in all this, but it's 25 books a week, 400 to 500 books you have to read in about a 6 to 9 month period. But, you know, so the world is changing. And certainly I'm going to be, I have a vote, and I'm very opinionated, and I'm going to start pushing for, you know, the literature I want to see rewarded. Anyway, thank you very much.
An applause. So to continue with the theme of envidia, not all envidia is bad. There's some good envidia, no? Envidia de la buena, como la que yo le tengo al maestro Troncoso. And that's good envidia. También me dio envidia alguien que pasó con un cafecito. Right? I said, I gotta get one of those. So we're gonna take a 5 to 10 minute break to get a coffee, and we'll be back. Thank you.